Good morning. A couple announcements today. Next Sunday, which is the 20th, please mark it down and make note that we are going to have a unity service with Telos, and it is going to begin at 10 a.m., not 11. Also as part of the service, we will have the ordination and installation of the new members of session. And following it, we will have a brunch. And I believe Pat McDonald has an announcement. Yeah? Oh, Barbara McDonald has an announcement.
Next Sunday, we will also finish our food drive at 10 yards. There's a man right there that you want to do this to be for the community. If you're right for the job here also, please hear Jesus said, as you do it to the least of these, you do it to the
least. Okay. Translating and amplifying for Barbara. Next Sunday, we will also be collecting for Second Harvest. We've got a box set up over there. Please be generous in your gifts to them. Susan?
I want to announce that we have a new director of the Child Care Center.
You do?
She's been with us for a week and a half now. Her name is Stephanie Pujo, and she comes from the Gardner School in Williamson County. She's been a teacher for many years. She was an assistant director and the director. So she comes to us with lots of experience. And if you get a chance, I know Pat's been back there to make her step back one day and say hello.
Very good. Susan's announcing that our new daycare director is on the job. Has she finished training you yet, Susan?
No.
Okay. It could be. Okay, please join me in the call to worship. God's world is a rich in mystery. We think we're sophisticated and knowledgeable until we are awestruck at the wonders of creation. Every seed, however small, contains a miracle and a mystery. Some come tiny seeds from huge bushes. At times, our own gifts and abilities seem so small, yet God can and will use our gifts in mysterious, amazing ways. Let us worship the God of tiny seeds and miraculous, mighty power. Let us pray. God, we turn our hearts and minds to you this morning, eager to your praises and to remember your grace toward us. You lift up our heads from the daily struggles of our lives. You remind us that the poor will not lose hope and the needy will not always be forgotten. By your Holy Spirit, fill us with joy and gratitude as we worship you. Amen.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Lord Jesus Christ, we remember with gratitude those people who generously sowed the seeds of faith in our lives. Above all, we recognize how you have blessed our lives with the gift of the Holy Spirit, so that our faith has miraculously and mysteriously grown. We confess the times we fail to involve ourselves in planting any seeds of faith in the lives of others. The times when our personal agendas become more important than yours. The times when you have denied others the opportunity to expand their faith through our lack of interest or involvement. The times when our lives become so entangled with the values of the world that we forget what you have said and done and promised. Lord Jesus Christ, we know that when we become disconnected from you, our lives become parched and unfruitful, and our faith becomes stunted and dry. Bless and renew our lives, we pray, so that we may remain connected to you at all times and in all places, strengthening our faith to expand and grow strongly and vigorously to hear the fruit of your mercy, your love, your undying life. Amen. Do not fear, children of God. Our Creator, the loving Maker of all reality, forgives us and redeems us from all that would keep us from growing. God sows the good news in tiny seeds, inviting us to tend the soil of beloved community and to marvel as they grow. In the name of Jesus, who is the Christ, you are forgiven. Amen.
Thank you.
Please be seated. Let us pray. Holy God, your word is a lamp unto our feet and a light for our path. Grant that your scriptures read today might, like small seeds, take root in our hearts and lives and grow us into your Son's likeness. Amen. The first scripture reading today is from Psalm 92, verses 1 to 4 and 12 to 15. It is good to give thanks to the Lord, to sing praises to your name, O Most High, to declare your steadfast love in the morning and your faithfulness at night. To the music of the lute and the harp, to the melody of the lyre, for you, O Lord, have made me glad by your work. At the works of your hands, I sing for joy. The righteous flourish like the palm tree and grow like a cedar in Lebanon. They are planted in the house of the Lord. They flourish in the courts of our God. In old age, they still produce fruit. They are always green and full of sap, showing that the Lord is upright. He is my rock, and there is no unrighteousness in him. The word of God for the people of God.
At the title of today's sermon and thought, finally, some juicy stories, I'm afraid you're going to be disappointed. These stories are seedy. They're seed-y, as in they're about seeds. From the fourth chapter of Mark, verses 26 through 34. He also said, Jesus said, the kingdom of God is as if someone would scatter seed on the ground and would sleep and rise night and day, and the seed would sprout and grow, he does not know how. The earth produces of itself, first the stalk, then the head, then the full grain in the head. But when the grain is ripe, at once he goes in with his sickle, because the harvest has come. He also said, with what can we compare the kingdom of God? Or what parable will we use for it? It is like a mustard seed, which, when sown upon the ground, is the smallest of all the seeds on earth. Yet when it is sown, it grows up and becomes the greatest of all shrubs, and puts forth large branches, so that the birds of the air can make nests in its shade. With many such parables, he spoke the word to them as they were able to hear it. He did not speak to them except in parables, but he explained everything in private to his disciples. So many of us have been trained to see parables as fables or allegories, or worse, children's stories. Parables are none of those things. There are many folks throughout church history, and in particularly the last couple hundred years of American church history, who for whatever reasons needed to see everything in terms of heaven or hell, right, wrong, salvation, damnation. And those same folks have taught that kind of interpretation of parables. But parables are pretty much never about those kind of either-or dichotomies. The word parable is from the Greek para, meaning alongside, from which we get words like parallel, and balo, meaning to throw, which is where we get our word ball. They are stories meant to be thrown alongside our lives and meant to keep us in conversation with God and with one another. Here's how one author put it. A parable is, quote, intended to be disruptive, to interrupt what you thought you knew and not just teach you something, but actually to confront you with a surprising and often unwanted truth. So the idea that these are cute stories for children just doesn't hold a lot of water, although they are fun to tell the kids. Parables have layers. We peel them off as we have those conversations with them. Parables can be vastly different at different times in our lives. As we grow and move through life, that conversation with parables tends to grow and change too. When we look at our lives through the lenses of the parables, they tend to break our lives open, break open the kingdom of God in sometimes messy but beautiful ways. Eugene Peterson called parables narrative time bombs. They sit there all innocuous and full of sheep or seeds, and then boom, another way of looking at them comes to mind, along with another way of looking at and living into our lives and our faith. God knows we are prone to reduce a relationship to a rubric, to reduce a who to a how-to, to take a relationship of faith that is meant to be vibrant and turn it into a set of instructions, to take what is meant to be lively, dynamic, and make it static, to take something vibrant, make it stuck. So parables, these invitations to conversation with Jesus, these invitations to use our imaginations, parables are an important vehicle to help us get past our desire for a neat and tidy formula and move toward our need for a powerful story we can carry within us and we can live into. So let's read those two parables again. And this time I want you to try to forget everything you think you know about parables, about the kingdom of God, about Jesus, and listen as if for the first time as Jesus tries to explain just a little bit what the kingdom of God is like. The kingdom of God is as if someone would scatter seed on the ground and would sleep and rise night and day, and the seed would sprout and grow. He does not know how. The earth produces of itself, first the stalk, then the head, then the full grain in the head. But when the grain is ripe, he goes in with his sickle because the harvest has come. I'll slow down so we can get rid of feedback. Sorry. He also said, with what can we compare the kingdom of God? Or what parable will we use for it? It is like, thank you, Bethany, it is like a mustard seed, which, when sown upon the ground, is the smallest of all the seeds on earth. Yet when it is sown, it grows up and becomes the greatest of all shrubs, and puts forth large branches so that the birds of the air can make nests in its shade. So if parables are an invitation to conversation about faith, what is the conversation that Jesus is inviting us to in these parables? It might help to ask, what is the situation that Jesus was speaking into at that time? In the Gospel of Mark, the kingdom of God is a central theme. The Gospel of Mark was also written right around the time when there was a Jewish revolt against Rome, and as punishment in the year 70, Rome destroyed the temple. So the Romans had created a kingdom of terror. Then Jesus is introducing a whole new kingdom, the kingdom of God. Mark is writing here about a different kind of a different reign of God in the face of the utter destruction of this temple, this building around which they built their faith and their lives. In the face of the violence of their Roman colonizers, Jesus is bringing up an alternative view of what power and kingdom means. Perhaps these early Christians were asking, what does it mean to be followers of Jesus when the world has turned upside down and sideways? How do we live out our identity as Christians with all this upheaval around us? Anybody feel like they've been there in the last little while? Anybody asking, well, now what do we do? What does it mean to be faithful at any time, in light of any set of recent events? Seems like these parables might have something to say to us today, which is the superpower of parables. This first parable, in which someone plants seeds, they carry on with their life, the seeds grow, the planter harvests them, it is only found in the book of Mark. Maybe because it's kind of boring. There is nothing surprising here. It's an explanation of basic farming or gardening. It is about as suspenseful as Goodnight Moon or some other sleepy bedtime story. No plot twists, no surprises. And I have to say that that is so doggone comforting. If this is how the kingdom of God works, there's a whole lot going on that has nothing to do with how the planter behaves. I'm guessing that in all that time that planter was getting up and laying down and the seeds were growing, at some point that planter was probably a jerk for at least a minute. The seeds in the kingdom of God kept growing. It seems like it is just the nature, it's the character of God's kingdom to grow and produce sustaining harvests that will get a family or a village or a church through the next season. So when we get anxious about maybe not having tried hard enough or done enough or produced enough, we can trust that the seeds we are planting, the kind words, the loving gestures, the invitations to conversation, the invitations to relationships, whatever they are, God's kingdom is going to grow. It's a mystery to us, but somehow nothing is ever wasted in God's economy. Nothing is without possibility. Now, many of you are gardeners. You know that even though you probably could explain the science behind a seed sprouting and growing into a plant, it's still a little miracle whenever a seed does that. All you did was pretty much poke it into the ground. If that is how the kingdom of God works, even now, the things we have put out into the world for the sake of love, those things are germinating and growing. And then we get to the mustard seed growing into this great big bush. In the context of the day, this would have been really pretty funny. Mustard was a weed. And in Jewish dietary rules, it was an unclean weed. Mustard also grows and spreads under the ground and then pops up, so it can take over a garden. So why in the world is Jesus comparing the kingdom of God to an unclean and invasive weed? It's a little bit like us saying, the kingdom of God is like kudzu. What? Maybe it's because something that is so small, a mustard seed, has such surprising and relentless growth. Maybe Jesus is saying that, you know, God's kingdom may look like a weedy shrub, but it's a God-blessed shrub that provides some great shade for birds in comparison to other nations like Rome proclaiming its strength in more traditional ways. But maybe it's about turning our ideas about of greatness and how we perceive what is mighty upside down. Some of us, Jeanette, Blake, are literally master gardeners. Some of us, me, are really bad at houseplants. According to these parables, that's okay. God can work with that. Growth is inherent to the kingdom of God, and God can take our clumsy efforts and make something pretty great. It reminds me of what a friend once told me about ivy. She said, the best way to grow ivy is to throw it on the ground and tell it not to grow and watch it thrive. These parables about seeds, they're humbling, they're inspiring, and they're comforting. They're humbling because the kingdom of God is going to come about. It's going to grow with or without us. It's inspiring because my feeble efforts can be made into something amazing, something remarkable in God's kingdom. And it's comforting because the Lord knows on any given day I may be planting weeds, and God can work with that. When we pray, as we will in a little bit, thy will be done, thy kingdom come, in light of these parables, that prayer is as much about us as it is about the kingdom of God. Another way to pray that might be, let your kingdom grow in my life and in the lives of the people around me. And we can remember that small kindnesses matter. Simple courtesy matters. The small, sometimes insignificant feeling of the steps we take towards justice add up. And those things are growing in God's kingdom, and there will be a harvest one day. In fact, if we reckon back to the mustard seed parable, it's likely that those things that love and kindness, justice, they are growing like crazy, like kudzu, and may yet provide some shelter for those around it. What conversations might you have with those parables? What ways will they shape your prayers, the way you live your life? We can use parables to justify the way we already are, or we can accept their invitation to something more, an invitation to continue that conversation with our questions, our wonder, our maybes, and a willingness to be surprised, and a peace that God's kingdom will grow because that's what God's kingdom does, in us, around us, because of us, and in spite of us. In the name of Jesus, the teller and teacher of parables, amen.
For a moment of generosity, we'll revisit the Dalai Lama. Giving material goods is one form of generosity, but one can extend an attitude of generosity into all one's behavior. Being kind, attentive, and honest is dealing with others, in dealing with others, offering praise where it is due, giving comfort and advice where they are needed, and simply sharing time with someone. All these are forms of generosity, and they do not require any particular level of material wealth.
Please stand.
The things that you would bring before the Lord today and to your faith community as well. Kent. Yay. The McCluskeys celebrated their 52nd wedding anniversary this past week. Congratulations. Pat? Yay, yes, Anita is here. Emily.
This is a phrase under prayer. Our grandson Will is being left today at a skateboarding camp in Pennsylvania. And prayers for safety of skateboarding and bicycling, parkour, and gymnastics, and for all the students that are attending. It's wonderful and it's interesting.
Which is why it's wonderful, probably. Yes. I'm sorry, I need to stop and do the prayer part. I was all excited about anniversaries and stuff. Let's pray real quickly and then we'll get back to requests. God, we thank you for Kent and Emily and their faithfulness to one another and to you. And we thank you that Anita is here. And we thank you for Will's opportunity to go do all the dangerous things. And we pray that you would surround him with very soft and cushy guardian angels. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Mary. Mary's asked for continued prayers for John Roberts as he continues his healing from his recent stuff with stomach and all kinds of things, heart. Lord, we thank you for our brother John and ask that you would grant him patience with the process of following directions from doctors and healing and renewed energy. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Susan.
Prayers of comfort and strength for the family of Troy Gowdy, who died on Friday.
Okay. He had been in an accident.
And he's been unconscious for the rest of the
year. Yeah. Okay. For Trey Gowdy, Susan has asked prayers for his family. God, for Trey Gowdy's family, in his passing, that you would grant them comfort, that you would send the people they need to be around them to them. Lord, in your mercy. Are there others? Oh, Corey. Your uncle, what's his first name?
Wesley.
Wesley has cancer. Okay. Yeah, I'll lift him up. Yeah. Corey's asked for prayers for his uncle Wesley, who has been diagnosed with cancer and is not expected to live more than 3 years, that we pray for his family as they deal with that and wrestle with how to manage all that. God, we lift up Corey's uncle and the whole family, ask that you would give them peace in the midst of this storm and that you would comfort and lead and guide as they look at treatments and the next hard season. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Okay. And turning to Bethany, hi.
Hi, how you doing?
Hey, good.
Travel mercies for Lynette and myself and our two grandkids, Layla and Leland. We're going to North Myrtle Beach tomorrow. And pray for safety and patience.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I will tell you a really cute story Andy told me about Leland. He was just distraught in the earlier service because he was having BB withdrawal. And they went out on the playground, and Andy said, well, at least if he was crying out there, there was more space for it to go. And somebody said something about a ball, and apparently Leland went, ball? And that was that. So yeah. You have been replaced by a playground ball.
Yeah.
So, let's pray. God, we thank you for Bethany and Lynette and their wonderful presence in our midst. We pray that you would grant them traveling mercies and patience and just lots of great memories to be made. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayers.
Okay. And our digital sanctuary. Anyone have a prayer request? No? All right, then. Let's continue in our prayers with sung and spoken prayers.
You can use anything, Lord, you can use me. If you can use, Lord, anything, you can use me. Touch my heart, Lord, speak through me. If you can use anything, Lord, you can use me.
Gracious God, we lift our hearts in praise to you this day. Praise for your goodness, your mercy, your grace, and your faithfulness to us. We give you thanks for the many blessings you have showered upon us, friends, family, this church. We thank you, God, for the gift of your Son, Jesus, and for the ways in which he taught us to see the world through new eyes.
You can use anything, Lord, you can use me. If you can use anything, Lord, you can use me. Take my hands, Lord, and take my feet. Touch my heart, Lord, speak through me. If you can use anything, Lord, you can use me.
Holy God, it is our longing that we be used by you to bring light to a shadowed world, to bring hope to weary people, to bring joy to a people too long walking in sorrow. We humbly ask that you would sow within us the seeds of your kingdom, bringing to life those things that will give us what this weary world needs.
You can use anything, Lord, you can use me.
Sing with me.
If you can use anything, Lord, you can use me. Take my hands, Lord, and take my feet. Touch my heart, Lord, speak through me. If you can use anything, Lord, you can use me.
Triune God, you who are revealed to us as creator, redeemer, and sustainer, we lift the burdens of our hearts to you. We ask for healing for those we know and love who are ill in body, mind, or spirit. We ask for justice to be done for those who are victims of injustice. And we ask that you would be moving, healing, and leading in all the places and with all the people we have lifted to you, those spoken aloud and those held in the silence of our hearts. And with joy, we lift our voices together in the prayer Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Please stand. Let's sing hymn number 641.
Leaves a room for pride.
beloved of God, we are called to sow seeds in the kingdom of God, trusting that in God's good mystery, they will grow in ways we can barely even imagine. Go out into this world and get planting. And may the love of God and the grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit go with you. Amen.